If you teach God's word, hold forth God's word, and a man rejects it, that's his business. But it's sure our business to see it's held forth. And that we are a sweet smell, not a sour one. Whenever you wrongly divide the word, it's a sour smell in the word. Wherever that word of God is rightly divided and held forth with that love of God, in the renewed mind and manifestation, is always a sweet savor. You see, all the criticism of the world, all the persecution that they can heap upon us, does not deter us from being his ambassadors. For we are to have God reproduced within us. And if tonight you're afraid of criticism of the world, what people may say about you, what the establishment may say about you, if you're afraid of the persecution they're going to lay on you, you should never accept one of these. You ought to just quit the way College of Emporia and the way Corps and go home. Fish in your own little pond, write a completely new theological system, and come up with a new Bible. But for those of us who mean business in our day and in our time, who have no fear of what the adversary may say or do, criticism, persecution is not going to deter us. It didn't deter God's men in the first century. Why should it deter us in the 20th? Still the same God, sir. Look at Acts. Acts 16. Verse 16. Came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel, possessed with a spirit of divination, hokey poke, like the palmist, like the crystal ball, like a lot of others, met us. Now watch. Who brought her masters much gain. By what? Soothsaying. She brought her masters much gain. She was their source of income. She made it for them. The same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, who show unto us the way of salvation. Right on. Paul and Silas were absolutely men who were showing the people the way of salvation. Here's a devil spirit saying that through this woman. And this she did many days. This she did many days. Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the spirit that was in her, I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And he came out that same hour. Right away, booms, quick, right now. Well, now what's wrong with that? Well, I'll tell you what's wrong with it. Paul hit the people in the pocketbook. As long as you don't disturb their political tenets or their religious tenets and not disturb the power structure, the finances, the money stuff, you get along pretty good. But the moment something goes down and that money isn't there, then they start getting mad and they fight. I think within this past 8 months, how many institutions did we know of or took a look at, Irma Owens? Would I guess 23? How far would I be off? 25? Of all those that we looked at, only two were not of one denomination. All the other 23 belonged to one denomination. Broke. Why are they broke? No people. Now, when you don't have the people anymore, now you're going to get mad. Now you're going to use all kind of tactics that you can. One of the group that we visited had their top clergy training greyhounds that they were running in Florida at the time we looked at the place. Now, just why would you run greyhounds in Florida? I guess because you like greyhounds, huh? You like a dog? That's why you run. No. Whenever you run greyhounds in Florida, you got one purpose in mind. Money. It seems to me when you come down to that level, I'd turn to God's word and see if there wouldn't be a way to win the people. If the people are being blessed, if the people's lives are being changed, the places will be filled. Shoot. Anybody could build a local establishment with a steeple on top with 4,000 people in a big enough community in 1 year. That's right. Because there are still people who want to hear, people who want to know God's word. But it's got to be that word. There are a lot of people not going to like it because you're going to hit them on the power structure. As long as you don't disturb that, that equilibrium they don't have, but they think they do, they won't get mad. But once they get mad, honey, it's always persecution. Always criticism, always fault-finding. And you never took anything away from it to begin with. All you did was started giving people something that was worth living for. Now watch this develop, because they're really going to get mad now. And when her masters saw that the hope of their what? Gains was gone, they caught Paul and Silas and drew them. They didn't walk them in with flowers on their lapel and say, "Welcome in, sir." They drew them in. To the court. The marketplace is the court. Because the court was held in a public marketplace. Sometimes it's called the theater. Same words translated theater in the Bible. Under the rulers. And brought them to the magistrate, saying, "These men, being Jews, do exceedingly trouble our what?" Wow. "And teach customs which are not lawful for us to receive, neither to observe, being what?" Now, wait a minute. That's not what it said. In verse 19, when her masters saw that the hope of their gain was gone. But when they appear before the police, when they appear before the government rulers, that's not what they say. "Oh, they took the spirit out of this girl. Now we haven't got money left." They didn't tell the truth. They never knew, the liars. They always twist it around to make you look like the nincompoop. "And the multitude rose up to gather against them." The multitude believed what these old-time leaders in the community said, because Paul and Silas were just core grads going into a community. They hadn't lived there for 20, 30 years. And therefore, their word didn't stand in the court like the old timers stood. Sounds like this was written this afternoon.